Yeah, the title goes Vaccines and Immunological Markers for TB Prevention. I have been working on a vaccine for several years, asking basic questions or simple questions like, why is BCG ineffective or is it effective? How do we know whether BCG is effective or not? Is there a test to test the efficacy of BCG? Is a TST enough or do we need an IGRA or some other interferon gamma release assay to know? And we did answer some questions. I may not have enough time to present all of the data right here now, but all I can say is we were one of the first groups to say that the effect of BCG doesn't last for many years, in spite of being a live vaccine. So we need to think of probably a booster vaccine or a better vaccine for children to protect them from tuberculosis. So what are the impeding factors for the development of new vaccines, be it a booster or a new recombinant vaccine? We need to know the antigens are the most immunogenic protein, mycobacterial protein, which would induce the right type or the protective type of response. Also, do we have the right immune correlates or do we have surrogates of protection to know or to test the efficacy of a vaccine? Do we know the biomarkers of protection? And while working on this vaccine, on BCG, we did come across antigen 85A, which does induce protective T-cell responses. So I would also like to add here that antigen 85A was tested in children in South Africa. It did undergo a vaccine trial, but it was found that it was not so efficacious there. So just to go into that, our past work, we did publish about antigen 85A and its potential use as a booster vaccine. Its use in an in vitro T cell assay as a treatment correlate. Use of antigen 85A for specific interferon gamma T cell responses to be used as a surrogate marker for cell mediated responses. We also reported that antigen 85 is a promising vaccine candidate by virtue of its immunodominant nature. I would like to skip this slide. On another note, we also did some work to know if there are any hot spots for tuberculosis. So we compared two different wards under the DOTS treatment, and we saw that there was disproportionate rate of transmission in tuberculosis in a particular ward compared to a neighboring similar ward. So we did refer to this as a hotspot. I'll tell you the connection between the two. So to present our recent data, we wanted to determine latent TB. For latent TB, we know our previous speakers just now mentioned about TST and IGRA. So I'm not going into the details of that. We would also like to investigate immunological risk factors that would make a person vulnerable to develop latent TB or progress to active TB. And we aimed at deriving at an algorithm for identifying high-risk individuals. I think in an endemic country like India, there are several persons with latent TB. So do we have to identify high-risk individuals among people who have latent TB to be able to give them preventive therapy? That is the question we asked. And we did work on household contacts of pulmonary positive TB patients. About 1,000 of these household contacts were followed up. So I'll quickly show you the results. While we followed up these household contacts or HHCs, I'm talking only about the latent TB negative individuals right now in the best interest of time. So we followed them up and just to see and investigate who converted into latent TB positive. So we call them converters, or who continue to be non-converters, latent TB negative. Again, people who are LTBP positive, how many of them developed active TB, or how many of them progressed to develop active TB symptoms or remained non-progressors? So to start with, about 52% of them were LTBI positive. We enrolled the HSCs at the time of diagnosis of the index case, whereas 48% of them were LTB negative, and right now I'm presenting data only about the LTB negative individuals. So 24 months later, about 21% of these LTBI negative persons converted into LTBI positive, out of whom again 1.7% progressed to active TB. Just to show you the dynamics of people who converted to LTBI positive, 96 of them were LTBI negative to start with at baseline, and 53% of them converted to latent TB positive by 4 months, 69% at 6 months, and so on, till we followed them up for 2 years, where all of them turned into LTBI positive. And to see the dynamics of interferon gamma, which is a good indicator for LTBI conversion, the blue color indicates low interferon gamma levels, whereas the red or pink color indicates high interferon gamma. So if you see the dynamics starting at the baseline towards the left side, which we followed them up for 2 years, to the end of 24 months or 2 years, we do see more of the red color or high intense interferon gamma levels. So the study outcomes, we analyzed the data at baseline, but we categorized them based on the study outcome. So those who are LTBA negative and continued to remain LTBA negative, called them non-converters. And then the LTBI contacts who were converters and those who progressed to active TB. So I'd just like to compare the interferon gamma levels using CFP10 and ESAT6. These are the antigens used in the IGRA, the commercially available IGRA. And we compared them with the baseline levels of interferon gamma using antigen 85A, which I talked about during the beginning of my talk. So this is the algorithm that we arrived at. Those who are non-converters had low levels of interferon gamma to CFP and ESAT6 and high levels to antigen 85A. Those who converted were reverse, and those who progressed to active TB had high levels of these cytokines, not just interferon gamma, but other cytokines to both the antigens. So we would like to validate these biomarkers and to have a very focused study. We would like to identify hotspots where the transmission of TB is high at the community level, and then the high-risk individuals who are the household contacts, and validate these markers. I think I would stop there. Thank you.